We're getting started just a little bit late today because, I don't know, I just wanted to answer the things on the last day that we're going to go through. But I'm really grateful that you took over 60 degrees out on so late in November, and you decided to spend the afternoon with us. And I'm very, very grateful to you for doing that. The kids have worked very, very hard in this play, and as you will see, they've done a tremendous job. It amazes me to think that this play is over 300 years old, 330 years old, and yet it's given the speech for the fourth time, so I know a lot of you are. But really, Moliere, the nice thing about this play, Moliere used to target a lot of people, like the doctor in spite of himself, he targeted physicians, and the miser, he targeted tightwads, in Partook, he targeted religious hypocrites. So it seems like in every play, hypochondriacs, ballet girl type women. He always had someone to make fun of. But in this play, he really hits a lot of them. I mean, he not only hits people who are wannabes and, you know, don't actually be themselves and try to be someone else, but, you know, he hits the rivalry between artists, he hits the athletes. He hits, when you look at it, the nobility itself, he made fun of. And basically, the reason these plays last for so long is because we all know these people. These are people who are still with us today because he targets human nature. Moliere turns a mirror on us so we can see ourselves and not take ourselves too seriously. And that's why he has endured for all these years. And that's why these plays are so fresh. Even though they're over 300 years old, they could have been written yesterday. So, and I don't even know of a playwright living today that writes with such skill as Moliere did. So I think it's real important that the kids learn about him and study about him. And I think we've learned quite a bit in this play. I hope you really enjoy it. Thank you. I'd like to thank my wife, who's been videotaping and helping out, and a lot of parents that are not in the program who have come night after night and helped out at the booth. I'd like to thank all of them and everyone associated with our drama club because of the long hours that have been put in by the set crew and by the costume. And I know because I do a lot of hours myself, and it takes so much work to do this show. You have no idea. But I hope you enjoyed it. So without any further ado, we will perform for you the Bourgeois Gentilhomme, the Lady Gentleman by Moliere.
in mind, however, that it is through him that we are establishing our reputations, and that his money paves the way for the prize brothers. Here he comes.
Well, well, gentlemen, what have we here? May I have a look at your little ditty?
How's that?
Oh, what's that called? You're a prologue or dialogue of songs and dance?
Yes, sir. We're ready for you.
I'm sorry you had to wait for me, but the fact is that I am dressing myself this morning as do the people of quality. And I had a devil of a time trying to put on this pair of silk stockings that lazy tailor sent me.
You're here solely to await your pleasure, sir.
Good. Then I want you to wait until my new outfit arrives so that you might see me in it.
Whatever pleases you, sir.
You shall see me properly decked out from head to toe.
We do not doubt you, sir.
Yes.
This oriental robe was made especially for me.
It is truly beautiful, sir.
Yes. My tailor told me that people of quality dress like this in the morning.
It, suits you perfectly, sir.
Lackeys! Hey there, my two lackeys!
What is it, sir?
Nothing. I just wanted to see if you could hear me. How do you like my liveries?
They are magnificent, sir.
Mm-hmm. Lackeys!
Yes, sir?
Not you, the other lackey.
Sir?
Hold my rope. And this is something casual for my morning exercise.
It is truly elegant, sir.
Well then, let's have a look at your little drawer.
First, I would like you to listen to a melody that she used to compose for the serenade. She's a student of mine with a true gift for this type of thing.
Yes, but this isn't something for a student to do. Were you too busy to do it yourself?
Certainly not, misled by the word student. For the knowledge of this kind of student can outwit that of the greatest masters. Just listen, and you will find your melody to be incomparable to you.
Thank you. theme. Could you liven it up a bit here and there?
Sir, the music must coincide with the words.
Someone taught me a really nice one a while ago. How does it go?
In faith, sir, I have no idea.
There's lamb.
Lamb, sir?
Yes, lamb. Oh, how sweet and fit he did my genie appear. Oh, how fair and saintly, no lamb. Lamb? Could be as
thank you.
call a very nice piece of work, and there are some very wise sayings in it.
And now, for my part, I present a little work comprised of the most beautiful movements and attitudes
of the dancing here. Oh, must I picture them as shepherds again?
You shall picture them anyway. Ready dancers with solemnity. Begin. One.
Thank you.
next level. One, two, jump at it. When you thrust your muscles first, disengage yourself, then lean into that attack. One, two, let's go. Hit me for the follow through. Advance, rest from there. One, two, recover. Once again, four. One, two, jump at it. I got it, sir.
Sciences when I was young.
A most reasonable sentiment. Now I'm Closed to all each other without having to meet.
about them as there are about these.
To be sure, the consonant D, for example, is pronounced by placing the tip of your tongue up against that upper teeth. And the consonant is pronounced by placing the upper teeth against the lower lip.
had the devil of a time trying to put on this pair of silk stockings you sent me, and there are already two runs in them.
They'll stretch easily.
Well, of course they will if I keep getting runs. Moreover, the shoes you gave me are hurting me ferociously.
Not at all, sir.
What do you mean, not at all? Ow. Ow.
No, they don't hurt you at all.
I tell you, they're hurting me.
You're just imagining that.
I imagine it because I feel it. That's why.
Hold on, sir. Behold the most beautiful and best matched coat in all the court. Designed a city outfit with thousands of black. Is a true work of art, and I measure your most gifted tailors in court couldn't do as well had they had six tries at it.
What the deuce is that? You've got the flowers on upside down.
You didn't tell me, did you, that you wanted them right side up?
Did I have to tell you that?
Yes, indeed. All people of quality wear them thus.
People of quality wear them that way?
Yes, sir.
Oh, well, in that case, I guess it'd be all right.
If you wish, I'll put them right side up.
Oh, no, no.
Just like say the word.
No, I tell you, you did the right thing. Do you think it will look well on me?
What a question. I'll invite any painter with his brush to do better. I have an apprentice at my place who is the greatest genius in the world when it comes to making bridges. Another who's a talent for Douglas makes him the hero of our time.
Are the wings and plumes as they should be?
Everything is just right.
Good. Aha, my dear tailor. This is something you made from the material of my last outfit. I recognize it.
Well, sir, the fact that the material seems so beautiful to me, I felt like you needed to cut out a coat for myself. Would you like to turn on your outfit?
Oh, yes, give it to me.
Wait! That's not the way it's done. I have brought some people who will trust you to music. Clothes like these must be put on ceremony. You there! Enter! Dress the gentleman as you do, people will fall.
in everything. Lackeys! Lackeys! Follow me about town as I walk around to show off my new outfit.
Right.
shame. For example, do you happen to know what you are saying right now?
Yes, I know that what I am saying is right and that you are thinking about another way of life.
No, no, I'm not talking about that. What I am saying to you and what I am speaking with you right now, what is it?
Nonsense.
No, it's not that. What we are saying is the form of language we are using this instant.
Well, what about it?
What is that called?
That's called what everyone wants to call it.
That's prose, imbecile.
Prose?
Yes, prose. All that is not prose is verse, and all that is not verse is not verse. Prose. So there! That's what studying's all about. And you, Nicole, do you know what you have to do to say ooh?
What?
Go ahead. Say ooh and see.
All right.
Ooh. How strange it is to have to deal with simpletons. You bring your upper lower jaws closer together, but without clenching them entirely, and you extend the lips forward so that they protrude. Do you see? I'm counting.
That's just dandy.
Now, isn't that admirable?
Oh, and other things are entirely different. If only you had seen da, da, and fa, fa.
What is all this gibberish? What's all that gonna get you?
Seeing ignorant females drives me mad.
Go on, why send all those people packing with all their stuff and nonsense? Especially that lout of a fencing master who fills the house with dust.
Aha! That fencing master really grates you. Well, I'll teach you your own impertinence, Nicole. Now then, demonstrative reasoning, the line of the body. When you're pushing tears, you have only to do this. When you're pushing quart, you have only to do this. And that way, one can be sure of killing without being killed himself. Isn't it nice to be so sure of things when you're fighting someone? Go ahead. I'll show you. Take a few swings at me.
All right, like this?
Oh, oh, oh! Curse on the little vixen!
You told me to thrust.
Yes! But you're thrusting in tears before thrusting in court, and you're not giving me enough time to parry.
You're mad, my husband, with all your silly notions. And you've been acting this way ever since you started mixing with the nobility.
When I mix with the nobility, I show my sound judgment, and it's much better than mixing with your common folk.
Oh, yes, indeed. There's a great deal to be gained by keeping such fancy company. And you've been acting very smart with that fine count of yours who's got you so bamboozled.
Quiet! Do you realize who it is you speak of when you speak of the count? He's a man of much greater importance than you might think. A lord of great esteem at court who speaks to the king just like I speak to you. Oh, don't you think that it is an honor that a man of such quality is seen coming to our house so often and that he call me his dear friend and treat me as if I were his equal? Oh, you can never know how kind he's been to me and how much he has overwhelmed me with all of the compliments he has paid me in front of everyone.
Oh, yes, he's nice to and pays you compliments as he borrows your money.
Well, certainly. Isn't it an honor for me to loan money to a man of such rank? And could I do any less for a lord who calls me his dear friend?
And this lord, what does he do for you?
Oh, things that would astonish you if you knew.
How's that?
Enough, I can't explain all that right now. All you need to know is that I lent him money, he'll pay me back, I'm sure, and fast.
Let's wait for that.
Certainly. Didn't he tell me so?
Oh, yes, he won't fail to do so.
He gave me his word as a gentleman.
Fiddlesticks!
Ah, but you're a stubborn one, dear wife. Look, he'll pay me back, I'm sure of it.
And I'm sure that he won't, and that all those compliments are to puff you up.
What? Here he comes.
That's all we need now. He's going to have to borrow more money from you. Just the sight of it turns my stomach.
Hush! My dear friends, Monsieur Jourdain, how are you?
Well enough, sir, to render you whatever service I may.
And Madame Jourdain there, how is she?
Madame Jourdain is doing as well as she can.
My, Monsieur Jourdain, your attire is absolutely matchless.
Ah, ha!
Scratches can wear
As you see, sir.
Good heavens, I could hardly wait to see you. I respect you more than any man in the world, and I was discussing you again this morning at the same king's chamber.
You do me too much honor, sir.
In the king's chambers!
Come now, put your head.
Sir, I know the respect that I owe you.
Good lord, let's not stand on ceremony, I beseech you.
Sir!
I am your friend, Monsieur Jourdain, put it on.
Sir, I am your servant.
I'll not put my head on unless you put on yours.
Rather be unmannerly than bothersome.
I am your debtor, you know.
Yes, we only know too well.
You have generously loaned me money on many occasions, and you have obliged me with certainly the most gracious of manners.
You jest, sir.
But I know how to acknowledge favors and repay what is well.
I have no doubts about that, sir.
I'd like to settle right now, and I'm here so that we might work it out together.
There! Do you see your impertinence, wife?
I am a man who likes to discharge his debts as soon as possible.
I told you.
Let's see how much I owe you.
You and your ridiculous suspicions.
Do you remember the total amount of money you loaned?
Oh, yes, I believe so. I've kept a little memorandum. Oh, here it is. On one occasion, I lent you 200 louis d'or.
That is true.
Once, 60.
Yes.
And another time, 140.
You are right.
These three items amount to 460 louis, which comes to 5,060 francs.
Your figures are correct, 5,060
francs. 1,032 francs to your plume merchant.
Exactly.
2,080 francs to your tailor.
That is true.
4,379 francs, 12 sous and 18 airs to your cloth merchant.
The account is accurate, 12,018 airs.
And 1,748 francs, 7 sous and 14 airs to your saddler.
All true, what does that come to?
Sum total? 15,800 francs.
The sum total is exact, 15,800 francs. Now I do that the 200 pistoles which you are about to loan me, and that will make exactly 16,000 francs that I will pay you the first chance I get.
There! Didn't I tell you?
Hush!
Loaning me that someone to put you out of.
Oh, no!
That is milking you dry!
Get quiet!
You will get suspended because it's the slightest inconvenience.
Not at all, sir.
You won't get me until he's put you in the poorhouse.
Didn't I just tell you to be quiet?
If that would cause any difficulty, I could go elsewhere.
No, sir.
What a cajoler!
Hush!
He'll drain the last sword!
You'll be still!
I am admitting as this would gladly oblige me. But since you are my best friend, I thought that asking anybody else would be an impertinence to you.
You do me too much honor, sir. I shall go fetch what you need.
What? You're going to give him back too?
Well, what can I do? Do you expect me to refuse a man of such rank? A man who spoke of me only this morning in the king's chambers?
Off with you, you're worth two!
You are sad of countenance, madame. What can be the matter?
My head may be swelled, but it's still larger than my fist.
I do not see your daughter. Where is she?
My daughter is doing quite nicely where she is.
And how is she getting on?
On her two legs.
Wouldn't you like to come with her one of these days to say come with you or ballet and court?
Indeed, sir. We really do feel like laughing. Don't we ever feel like laughing?
I imagine Madame would dance in your younger days who had many sisters being in the world.
Indeed, sir. Has Madame Chopin grown too perfect? Does she have the shakes already?
In faith, madame, I beseech you to forgive my impertinence. I have some money more often than nothing. It did not occur to me that you are still young.
Here you are, 200 louis d'or in exact count.
I thank you, Monsieur Jourdain, and assure you of my most gracious services to you at once.
I shall be much obliged, sir.
If Madame Jourdain wishes to see a royal entertainment, she shall have the best seats in the house.
Madame Jourdain kisses your hand.
As I advise you, my letter, our beautiful Marquise will be here soon for, say, ballet and dinner. You are planning your own.
Let's move off of it, for obvious reasons.
It's been 8 days since our last meeting, and I have nothing to worry about, so I gave it to give me, which I was to present to you, or which I was to present to her as a gift from you.
How did she like it?
She loved it. And unless I am sadly mistaken, it will have the most favorable effect on her feelings towards you.
Oh, would to heaven that be so.
Once he's with him, he can never part company.
I got you to appreciate the richness of the gift and the depths of your love.
Sir, may I say that it astounds me to see a person of your quality stoop to do what you are doing for me.
You jest, sir. Do scruples of that sort carry any weight with friends? And would you not do the same for me were the occasion to arrive?
Oh, certainly, and with the greatest of honor.
Oh, how his presence weighs on me.
For my part, when it comes to serving friends, nothing else matters. And when you told me in confidence about your arduous feelings towards a delightful marquise who I know socially, you saw how quickly I offered to serve their cause of love.
True. These favors are what astound me.
Will he ever leave?
They do get on, though.
You're taking the right steps to captivate her, for there is nothing that women love more than the money spent on them. And your incessant bouquets, the frequent serenades, and the fireworks on water, the diamond you gave her, and the ballet dinner which you are planning this evening will all serve your cause of love far more eloquently than any words you yourself love.
Oh, if money could put me on the road to her heart, I would spend my last sou. A woman of quality has charms that dazzle me, and it is an honor that I would buy at any cost.
What are they talking about all this time? Go sneak up on them and listen.
You may soon have the pleasure of seeing her, and then you may feast your eyes to your heart's content.
To have a free reign, I've arranged to have my wife dine at my sister's, where she'll spend the entire afternoon.
You did the right thing, for your wife's presence would complicate matters a bit. I've given all the necessary orders to the chef and the dancers, and I've planned the entire affair, and if all of my orders are carried out...
step for step in her headlong rush to change things, So it will not be she alone who will reap satisfaction from our separation.
Beautifully said, sir. Those are my sentiments exact.
Help me to retain my ill feelings towards her and resist whatever remaining tenderness I might feel that might cause me to speak in her favor. Describe her to me in such a way as to have her appear contemptible in my eyes. Emphasize all the defects you see in her that should arouse my displeasure.
In her, sir? She's a childish snob. A pretentious coquette whose physical attributes are hardly enrapturing. I find nothing in her that is not mediocre. But, sir, you could find 100 others more worthy of you. First of all, she has small eyes.
That's true. Her eyes are small. But they're full of fire. They sparkle, they pierce, they excite like nothing else on earth.
Well, she has a wine mouth, huh?
Yes, but it is charm that is not found on other mouths. The desire that wells up in me when I gaze upon it renders it the most attractive mouth in the world.
Well, she's rather large and filled, sir.
Yes, but she's graceful and well-proportioned.
She affects a nonchalance of speech and action.
Yes, but she does so with such grace, and her ways are so engaging, so indescribably charming, they capture my heart.
Well, as for her wit,
that she has, Coquille, the most refined, most delicate.
Her conversation
is charming.
She's always serious.
Would you prefer a perpetual display of joviality? Is there anything more insufferable than a woman who will laugh at anything?
Lastly, she's as capricious as anyone I know in this world.
Yes, she is capricious. But when a woman is beautiful, everything about her is becoming, and there is nothing that we cannot endure.
Well, since that's the way it is, it's obvious you wish to love her always.
I would rather die, and I will hate her as much as I love her.
And how do you plan to do that, since you find her so perfect?
My vengeance will be all the more striking because of this. As beautiful, attractive, and lovable as I find her, I shall nonetheless hate her and leave her, and this will amply demonstrate my strength of will. Here she comes.
For my part, I was thoroughly shocked.
I didn't mean nothing else, Miss Cole, but what I said. But there he is.
I don't even want to speak to her.
I should be glad.
What is this all about, my aunt? What's troubling you?
What ails you, Coquille?
What is it that grieves you thus?
What is it that puts you in such bad humor?
Have you lost your tongue, my aunt?
Are you dumb, Coquille?
Oh, what a brazen creature. Oh, what a Judas.
I can see that our recent meeting has upset you.
Aha! She has realized what she has done.
The reception we gave you this morning got your dander up.
Ha! She has guessed her, shouldn't it?
Isn't it true, Cleon, that this is the cause of your resentment?
Yes, that is it, faithless one. And since speak I must, I say you are wrong to think that your unfaithfulness will prevail. I will be first to end our relationship, thereby depriving you of the satisfaction of rejecting me. It will be difficult for me to overcome my love for you. It will occasion much anguish. I'll suffer for a time, but I will get over it. And I would rather put a dagger through my heart than to be so weak as to return to you.
Ha! That goes for me, too.
That's much ado about nothing. I'd like to explain to you why I avoided you this morning.
No, I don't want to hear it.
I'd like to tell you why we passed you by so quickly.
No, I don't want to listen.
I want you to know that this morning...
No, I tell you.
I want you to understand.
No, traitorous.
Listen.
I'll have none of it.
Let me explain.
I am deaf.
My aunt.
No.
Call me out.
Not at all.
Stop this.
Nonsense.
Hear me.
Bull rock.
Wait a moment.
In no way.
A little patience.
Fiddlesticks.
It's two words.
No. since this is your wish.
I wish you to try?
Yes.
Who told you this?
What else am I to make of your refusal to remove my suspicion?
Am I to blame? Had you only been willing to listen to me, I would have told you that the incident that has so sorely grieved you was due to the presence this morning of an old aunt who is convinced that a girl is dishonored by the mere approach of a man, lectures us constantly on the subject, and depicts all men as devils to be shunned.
This is the truth you're telling me, isn't it, Lucille?
They're not lying to us?
Nothing could be more true. That's exactly the way it was.
Well, sir, do we accept this?
Lucille, just one word from your mouth and the anguish of my heart is appeased. Who could resist the persuasion of one's beloved?
With what ease are these infernal creatures can deal with?
I am pleased to see you, Pam, and arrived just in time. Here comes my husband. Now is the moment for you to ask Lucille's hand in marriage.
Madam, what sweetness to your words of pain. How they respond to the yearnings of my heart. Could there ever be a more delightful order, a more precious favor? Sir, for some time now, I've wanted to make a certain request of you. The matter is of such moment to me that I've decided to do so personally rather than engage anyone else to act on my behalf. And without further ado, I'll ask of you the glorious honor of becoming your son-in-law.
Before giving you my answer, may I ask you, sir, if you are a gentleman?
Sir, most people can answer that question with little hesitation or difficulty. They have no qualms about assuming that title, seem to do so nowadays with the blessings of society. As for myself, I must confess that my convictions in this regard are somewhat stronger. I believe that all forms of imposture are unworthy of a man of honor, that it is shameful to disguise what heaven has made us by parading about with a false title, presenting a false image of oneself. For my part, those poor parents who held positions that were undoubtedly honorable. I acquired the honor that comes from 6 years' service in the military, and my resources are sufficient to maintain a passively high rank in this world. But in spite of all of this, I have no intention of bestowing on myself a title which others in my position would feel justified laying the claim. And so I'll say to you frankly, sir, that I am not a gentleman.
Let's shake on that, sir. My daughter is not for you.
What?
You're not a gentleman. You shall not have my daughter.
What is all this gentleman stuff? Does our family descend from San Luis?
Hold your tongue, wife. I know what you're leading up to.
Don't both of us descend from plain working people?
There goes that slanderous tongue of yours again.
And wasn't your father a tradesman just like mine?
The devil take that woman. It's always the same story with her. Look, if your father was a tradesman, that was his misfortune. But only the ignorant would say that of my father. For my part, I want a gentleman for a son-in-law.
What your daughter needs is a husband who suits her. She'd be better off with an upright young man who's rich and handsome than with a penniless and homely gentleman.
That's true. We have the son of a gentleman in our village who is the biggest and clumsiest nincompoop I ever saw.
Nicole, you're forever sticking your big nose in the sides of the conversation in which you don't belong. Look, I have enough money for my daughter. All that I need is honor. Thus, it is my wish that she become a marquise.
A marquise?
Yes, a marquise.
God forbid.
My mind is made up.
And my mind will never consent to it. There can be painful disadvantages to marrying above one's station. I don't want a son-in-law to reproach my daughter for her parents, nor do I want their children to be afraid to call me grandma. If she had to visit me as a grand lady and if by accident she failed to greet someone along the way, they'd be quick to say all sorts of nasty things about her. Things like, look at the fancy marquise with her haughty airs. She's the daughter of Monsieur Jourdain. When she was young, she was only too happy to play the fine lady with us. She wasn't always as uppish as that. Her two grandfathers sold cloth and made a lot of money for their children. They're probably paying now for in the other world, for you don't get rich by being honest. I'll have none of that tittle-tattle. In a word, I want son-in-law who hold him to me for my daughter, to whom I can say, sit there, son-in-law, and join me for dinner.
There goes that small mind of yours at work again, always clinging to the bottom rung of the ladder.
sword you found. Follow me, child. You must tell your father at once that your marriage failed, or you'll marry no one.
Could you really handle that well with your fancy notions? What would you have me do? For me, it was a matter of principle. Principles? With a man like that? Can't you see that he's mad? But it costs you anything to go along with his fancies.
Well, you're right, of course. But I didn't think I would need proof of nobility to be the son-in-law of Monsieur Jordan.
Proof of nobility?
What are you laughing at?
I just thought of this great idea to trick our man into giving you exactly what you want.
Well, what is it?
The idea is really quite funny.
Well, let's go out with it.
There's a certain masquerade form recently that fits in just perfectly here. I plan to make it all part of a joke as you'll plan her foolish friend. The whole thing may be a bit farcical, but with him, we can venture anything. There's no need for elaborate subterfuge. He plays role marvelously. He'll believe whatever nonsense we need to tell him. I have the actors and the costumes. You have the team.
Oh, but tell me.
I must withdraw. Here he comes.
Trouble me for two reasons. One is that it's going to be more than I can do, and the other,
is a great honor for me to see myself being so fortunate as to have the good fortune of your having had the kindness to come with. And if I merit it enough to, merit a merit like yours, and if heaven, if heaven, envious of my good fortune, had granted myself the advantage of seeing myself worthy of the, deserve such consideration.
Take care not to mention the diamond you gave her.
Can I even ask how she likes it?
How's that? You must do nothing of the sort. To do so would be most ungentlemanly, and to exhibit even a refinement to which pretends it was not you who gave it to her. He says, Madame, he is delighted to have you as his guest.
He will be glad for me.
How obliged I am to you, sir, for speaking to her thus in my behalf.
I can't tell you how difficult it was for me to get to come here.
I don't know how I will ever repay you.
He says, Madame, he considers you the most beautiful person in the world.
How very gracious of him.
Madame, it is you who are gracious.
And let's proceed to the dinner.
Anything you say, sir.
Let's sit at the table and bring in the musicians.
Most ungentlemanly of me. And besides, the diamond is is a mere trial, for you, madam, are something far more beautiful.
Do you mean Monsieur Jourdain is more beloved than I thought?
Cosette?
For whom do you take me, Monsieur Jourdain?
I should have her take me for what I would say.
Again?
You don't know me.
She shall know me whenever she pleases.
Monsieur Jourdain is a man who say ready with, but would you have not observed that he waits for you to serve yourself in the needs which you leave behind?
Monsieur Jourdain is a man who charms me.
Oh, if I could charm your heart, I would be.
I just
was a gentleman. Sir, I shall proclaim that to the entire world. I shall be much obliged. May I ask the nature of your visit?
Ah, since my last meeting with your late father, I have traveled all over the world.
All over the world?
Yes.
I said that's quite a ways from here.
Ah, to be sure. I returned from these voyages just 4 days ago. And because of my concern for anything that might affect you, the son of this distinguished gentleman, I've come to bring you the best news in the world.
Pray, what might that be?
Should be my cool tomorrow.
warned you that was funny. Did you learn his role by heart? He couldn't have possibly played it any better.
Bala.
Here we are.
Siobhan!
Yeah!
is a very high dignitary, and they have just now performed a ceremony.
What ceremony?
Mamma Mucci per Giordina.
What does that mean?
Giordina, that is to say, Jordan.
What about Jordan?
Vole far un paladina de Giordina.
What kind of gibberish is that?
Dar trabanta con galina.
What?
Dara, dara, bastina!
What, what's the meaning of all this?
Non te ne tonta. Questa star, non ti ma frutta. Cunna, ma, balla, ciao, balla, 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 ta!
Heaven help us, my husband has gone mad.
Be still, insolent one. You must show respect to your Mamma Mucci.
Where did this madness come upon him? Quickly now, I must prevent him from going out. Thou calling me now, I've got trouble clothes on me for all sides.
Yes, madame, you are about to witness a most amusing episode conceivable. Where you deserve to say world over, you would not possibly find a man more mad than me. And then we must search the cause of Leon's love. He is a very decent lad, and he is worthy of our concern.
He is a good lad, and I think very handsome.
Aside from that, there shall be a ballet performance which we should not miss for something most to our liking. And then I must see if an idea of mine will succeed.
I have seen the magnificent preparations, as these are things to allow that I can no longer do. Yes, it is my wish that we finally put an end to these lavish expenditures on my behalf. And to see that you do, I have decided to marry you. There is no further delay. It's a true secret to all these things, the ultimate will be to marry.
Is it possible, madame, that you favor me with such a sweet decision?
This is only to avoid your total impoverishment, since it is obvious that at this rate you shall soon lose our estate.
Madame, I thank you for your concern over my estate.
I shall make you suppose. But here is our man. What a vision of splendor.
Sir, madame and I have come to render homage for your newly bestowed dignity, and to rejoice with you over the forthcoming wedding of your daughter, the son of the great king.
Sir, I wish you the strength of snakes and the prudence of serpents.
Sir, I for one am extremely pleased to know what to do on my first congratulations. I your glory that you have just been elevated.
Ah, madame, shall madam, may your rosebush be in bloom all year. And may I say that I am extremely grateful to you for taking part in the honors that are happening to me, and that I am very glad to see you here again in my house so that I might apologize most humbly for the nastiness of my wife.
Oh, is that nothing? Such a point that it is excusable this occupied young woman to be your precious. And it is not at all strange that the position of man like you should inspire. Please hold on.
The possession of my heart is a thing which you have completely acquired.
As you see, madame, Monsieur Jordan is not a man who is blinded by his own prosperity. Despite his rise of fortune, he still deigns to recognize his friends.
This is remarkably cruel, generous person.
Where is the Turkish hiding so we may pay him our respects as friends of yours?
Ah, I hear him coming. Ah. Oh, I've sent for my daughter to give him her hand in marriage.
Sir, we bow before you as friends of your father-in-law and assure you of our most humble services as friends.
Oh, where the devil is that interpreter? Tell him who you are and have him understand what you mean. Oh, you'll see that he speaks Turkish, and marvelously at that. He'll answer you. Hey there! Interpreter!
Oh.
Strip, strap, screw. Okay. The gentleman is a grand signor, grand signor. And the lady is a dama, grand dama. Oui? Oh my. Put here. Him, sir. Him, French, Mamma Mucci. And her, French, Mamma Mucci lady. Oh, my, I can't speak any more clearly than that. Oh, there you are! Why the devil? possibly wish. Behold, the husband that I give you.
To me, father?
Yes, to you. Come now, join hands with him so that he might be assured to have a good fortune.
I do not wish to get married.
Well, I wish it, and I am your father.
I should not be of the sort.
Enough of them. Come now, your hand. And my wife.